Hallelujah. Come on, Elevation, give it up for Lara Judge. You're not clapping like you're blessed this morning. Somebody give the Lord a shout of praise today. Have you said Happy Valentine's Day to your neighbor? Some people are saying it frowning. I don't understand that. That doesn't, you know, there's a way Valentine looks. Valentine always wears a smile. I hope you understand what I'm saying. Yeah, so say it better now. Say Happy Valentine's Day to your neighbor and smile. Praise God. Thank you so much, Lara. God bless you. Wonderful, wonderful. One more time, let's appreciate Lara. Thank you. Wow. February is a special month, and it's a month that reminds us of love, of you know, affection, of romance. By the way, I've been missing in action, and it's good to be back. Praise God. I watched the services online last Sunday. It was a great job. Pastor T in the first service, my wife in the second service. Let's appreciate them. Great job they did last Sunday. And we started out, you know, on that discussion about this month. But before I get into the short exhortation that I have this morning, this is a special service, and this is just going to be short. I just want to quicken our heart and our minds today on what is in the air. And then we're going to pray and take one more music presentation from the Elevation Priest of Praise and bring the service to a close. So if you're here and you're wondering what's happening here, everything looks red. Even Pastor is in red tie. I'm just confirming. And you can conform to whatever is good. The Bible only says we should not conform to what is bad. Praise God. Yeah, so it's just in the spirit that is in the atmosphere. By the way, how was your week? You know, some people all through this week, some especially the singles, you've been staying awake wondering if somebody will send card or send. At least after tonight, you sleep. Praise God. Everything will all come to an end by midnight. Yeah, and somebody will have peace. And for all the guys who have also been thinking, how do I go about this? You need to learn. Praise God. I'm talking to single guys, right? You have mentors in the house. Ask them after the service. They will teach you what to do. This is my 12th Valentine post-marriage. And I got it wrong sometime. I remember wrong so well. And yesterday, she was struggling to locate the venue. And people were asking after her. The event had started. She had not arrived. You know, I took it upon myself to make sure that she got in on time. So I went outside calling, you know, directing and all that. By the time she came, she was so overwhelmed that I cared so much, you know. And it was because while all that was happening, the Holy Spirit was ministering to me. I can use anything to turn anything around. And I can use this occasion, you know, to just make things better within your family. And you are supposed to portray the love of God, being a called person who should understand the love of God more. I hope you understand what I'm saying. Yeah. And I just leveraged on that. And it just kind of helped. Because everybody left yesterday happy, you know, smiling, and everything was just great. As in, I went out of my way to meet cousins I've not seen in 15 years. You know, give them my number. It's you. We only see you on TV. I humbled myself. Oh, it's so good to see you. Do you want my number? That's how you leverage on events, on happenings, to renew, to let people know that you have grown beyond where you used to be, where you used to lock up the love of God in your heart. And that you struggle to let people know that you care about them. To let people know that you care about how their life will go and how things will end with them. You know, when you live in a metropolis, there's this danger of thinking that life is all about you and you and you alone. So you care about which school your kids go. You care about the next job that you want to get. But you've forgotten that this world does not revolve only around you. And when we get to, you know, the hereafter, how you distribute the love of God matters in your divine placement. Yeah. I hope you understand what I'm saying. It's not going to be about the job that you got, or the house, or the car. It's the distribution of the love of God that has been placed in your heart. You know, one thing that will be remembered in heaven, good deeds. The show of love. That all that will be remembered in heaven. There are many things that will not be remembered in heaven. I can't go into it this morning. I don't want to digress from my message. But there are many things that will not be remembered in heaven. But there are many things that will be remembered, and those are based on how we distribute the love of God. How we distribute the love of God. Those are the only things that will be remembered in heaven. Can you tap your neighbor for me this morning and ask your neighbor, how dwelleth the love of God in your heart? So, whether or not you choose to love, who you love, that's why I woke up this morning, you know, sent a tweet. I was warning my Twitter followers, be careful how you love. Who you love and who you refuse to love affects your life. So be careful how you love. Because today people are going to love anyhow. And some people loving anyhow, just today, you leverage on today anyhow, you end up where you're not supposed to be. Yeah. I just told you how to leverage a special day like this to enter more into the center of God's will for your life. Because if love is really bubbling in your heart, why don't you pick your phone after the service? If you haven't spoken to your parents in a while, call them. If there's a cousin that you don't see eyeball to eyeball, send a text. And don't bother whether they reply or not. Yeah. Because it's just the love of God that you are distributing. Yeah. Jesus did not care about whether people reciprocated his love or not. Unconditional love does not seek reciprocity. I hope you understand what I mean. It does not seek that people reciprocate. No. It's just distributed. It's just distributed. So I want somebody to understand this morning that this is a season to leverage on to show that the love of God dwells in your heart. To show that the love of God dwells in your heart. You need to demonstrate it. You need to show it. You need to show that love is more than feeling. You need to show that God is dwelling in your heart. Love is more than feeling. It's a nature. And it's also a decision. It's a nature, it's a decision. God is love, the Bible says. And whosoever is in God is a love being. You see, 1 Corinthians 13, it was written very poetic and all that, but it was written so that we understand that love is a noun, not a verb, as it were. Or both, but it was, because it says love, is humble. It was describing a personality, and that's the personality of God. Have you read that before? 1 Corinthians 13. Love is gentle. Love is patient. He was a person that Paul was describing there in that epistle. And when you read 1 Corinthians 13, do you see a persona that has similarity with you? Because that's how we can gauge ourselves. So it's not okay to just say, love is kind, love is patient, love is this. It's, when I read that, I look at it like, is this scripture describing me? Because this looks like a personality, a person. So love is more than a feeling, it's a nature. It's a nature that we have. When God looks down from heaven, because of the love that he has given you, what he's looking out for, is that are you living up to expectation? There's some people here this morning. Now you're supposed to be in a secondary school of love, as it were. You're supposed to be a teenager in your love walk, but you're still in diaper in your love walk. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. Yeah. Somebody talks like this. Yeah? Your own love, how do I put it? You know, it's possible for somebody's love to not understand patience. Yeah, but you say, I love, but it's just like, I just can't be patient. No, but it's a complete thing. And you know, the truth is just like when we were in school. If you fail an elective, they may let you go. But if you fail a core course, you do what? I said, you do what? You receipt back in the day. Today, you don't receipt. It's extra semester. Am I saying the truth? Yeah. The people who went to OAU, they're different from people who went to University of Ife. There's no better way to describe it. Just pardon me. The people who went to University of Ife, they used to do receipt. When it became OAU, there was no more receipt. You will come back for extra semester. Am I saying the truth? Yeah, I was just talking about people who schooled in the 90s and, you know, after the year 2000. There's no more receipt. You write it again. Some people are doing, you know, too many extra semester. Right now, in marriage, extra semester in relationships, just simply because you have refused to focus on a certain core of what love is all about. As I round off this morning, I want to ask the question again. Is the love of God truly in your heart? Can I help somebody to understand how we receive the love of God this morning? Can you put my last slide on? I want to challenge you as we go into 2016. This is just the second month. I need you to carefully look at this and gauge yourself this month of February and make a decision. This is a pyramid of your walk with God, especially when it comes to loving Him. And we start by knowing God, then we go to loving God, and then we go to serving God and sacrificing for God. A lot of the time when we get into the kingdom of God, most people just want to jump to the highest level without taking. See, you know the truth. You cannot love the person that you don't know. Yeah. When you say I love you to a stranger, it's just a cliche. Am I saying the truth? Yeah, it's just a cliche. Just a cliche. It's nothing more than a cliche. When you say I love you to a stranger, maybe you are echoing a song. It's not from your heart. But when you know someone deeply, then you can really say I love you. And it's when you love someone that your service makes sense, because it's born out of love. You are here serving in this church, and there are many other reasons why you serve apart from the love for Jesus. Your service may not make sense. You serve here because you are close to Pastor Godman. Your service will not make sense. Can you hear me tap your neighbor this morning? Do you know Jesus? Have you received His love in your heart? You know, some people mark attendance in church. Yeah. Some people mark attendance in church. Yesterday at my brother's party, I saw one or two people. By the time I asked my PA to find out, the guy just came in to eat. He didn't know us. Yeah. That's how it is. Some people just come into church, they don't know Jesus. When the roll call is called up yonder, when we want to say thank you to all the people that came yesterday, there's no way we can say thank you to Him. He ate our rice, but no, because He didn't. Yeah. And if you're like that here this morning, you need to understand what I'm talking about. The reason why you can be this cantankerous, everybody's begging you, don't break this home, and you're insisting it's going to break, let it break. You don't know Jesus. If you do, the love of God will dwell in your heart. And the Bible says the love constrains you. Yeah. That love will constrain you to do the right thing. It will constrain you to do the right thing. You can't be in a church like this and it's only evil that is in your heart consistently. You don't know Jesus. Because if you know Him, then you start to love Him. And if you love Him, His love will flow into your heart. His love cannot be dwelling in your heart and evil will still have a place. Check your heart this morning. If you still have a large appetite for evil, how dwelleth the love of God in your heart? The people here this morning who are looking forward to being able to serve God, make sure that you know him. Start to love him. Then your service will be acceptable. And you can then join those of us who have decided to sacrifice our lives for Jesus. There's no greater love than this, than for a brother to lay down his life for his friend. That's what Jesus said, and that's what he did. Lay down his life for us. Sacrifice his life for us. I want to pray this morning that couples in this house, you really be able to sacrifice your life for your spouses. I want to pray for people here this morning who may be separated, divorced, you know, who may be widowed, that the love of God will still find a place in your heart. That God will lead you to the path of the fulfillment of your marital destiny. That where the world has said it has ended for you, God will reveal himself to you in a new way. That his love will fill your heart this season more than the love of a man or the love of a woman. Glory to Jesus. I said glory to Jesus. Lift your right hand with me this morning. And I wanted to talk to God today. Talk to God today. Talk to God today. If you're here and you're single, I wanted to talk to God today. That you will be able to find the love of God before you find a man or a woman. Because if you have not found the love of God, you cannot be an asset in a relationship. You can't be an asset in a relationship. You will not be an asset in a relationship. Can you ask God, Lord, help me to find your love. Help me to find your love. That's what I ask you. You're single here this morning. You cannot give what you don't have. Help me to find your love. Help me to find your love in my heart. You're here this morning, you're married, but you're in a loveless relationship. I pray for you today. But that seemingly unlovable person that you're with, that God will touch their heart and transform it. That God will turn around the evil tide of hatred and bitterness in your home and give you new beginnings this season. That's my prayer for you if you're in a loveless relationship right now. We thank you because as we release our faith in giving today, we decree that the remaining days of this month and this year, there shall be no lack in any life. We thank you because our bills are paid, our debts are paid up. We live in abundance. And we have much more to give to demonstrate your love. We thank you and we praise you. We thank you for a new week filled with new testimonies of favor and of all-round increase. In Jesus' precious name. Say better amen. Amen. All right, the ushers will move around to take the offerings from us. And now I'd love to really welcome our guests. If it's your first time ever at the Elevation Church, I want to welcome you very, very specially. It's a privilege and an honor to have you worship with us in this service this morning. If it's your first time ever at the Elevation Church, can you please wave your hands? Wherever you may be sitting, can you wave your hands? My first time at the Elevation Church. If you don't mind, can you stand just for a moment? We have some special gifts that we want to give you and our ushers will be able to locate you. If you are standing, Elevation, can we put our hands together and welcome all of our guests? People are standing all around the auditorium. Come on, be warm to our guests. If you're sitting around them, please shake hands with them. Welcome them very, very specially to the Elevation Church this morning. Welcome them very specially. Come on, let's do it a little more. Let's appreciate our guests. Let's appreciate them. Praise God. If you have received a gift from our ushers, you may please take your seat. You may take your seat. If you're here to receive that gift, you can just wave your hands. They will still get one across to you. While you're seated, wave your hands. I can see a hand towards the back there for our hospitality team. Please let's get the welcome pack across to the sister. God bless you. Thank you very, very much for coming to be.